Wheatstone bridge is like any other, an electric circuit. Invented by Samuel Hunter Christy in 1833 and improved and popularized by Sir Charles Weston in 1843, this circuit network is an arrangement of four resistors which are arranged as you see. We have resistor R1, R2, R3, and R4. Those are the four resistors that make up the Wheatstone bridge. R1 is an unknown resistor, which we are definitely supposed to find. R2 is a standard or a resistor whose resistance is known. Then R3 and R4 are resistors that are variable resistance, but whose resistances still can also be read. So when we vary the potential differences using these variable resistors, the potential difference or the potential at B and the potential at D will keep varying. If the potential at D is greater than the potential at D, it means that current will flow from D to B and it will cause that galvanometer to deflect. If the potential at B is greater than the potential at D, it means that current coming in will flow also in through the galvanometer from B to D, and it will cause this galvanometer to deflect in the opposite direction. So it means that if we vary these resistances such that the potential at B and the potential at D is the same, then it means that the galvanometer will not deflect. When the galvanometer does not deflect, it means that there is no current going through the galvanometer. This condition whereby there is no current that is going through this galvanometer is what we call the balance condition. Balance condition for a Wheatstone bridge, we are going to do it in two ways. We can either derive it using kirchoffs laws of electrical networks, or we shall derive it on the basis of the physical conditions that are supposed to exist for balance condition to be called so. So we shall begin off with kirchoffs laws. In this circuit diagram, this is a Wheatstone bridge, just a portion of the Wheatstone bridge. We have this first loop and the second loop inside a Wheatstone bridge that is having resistances R1, R2, and two variable resistors R3 and R4. Plus our galvanometer G. Previously, we had just said that for the Wheatstone bridge to be considered to be at balance condition, it means that no current is supposed to be flowing through the galvanometer. So this is I0 current coming into the bridge. When it gets to that junction, it splits into I1 and I2. And I1 will go all the way, and I2 will go all the way. It will recombine here back to I0. So we begin with loop 1. We know that according to the voltage law of kirchoff, all the voltages within this loop must be equal to zero. The algebraic sum of all the voltages in this loop are equal to zero. So we begin by first allocating the potentials on the resistors. This is current, it is flowing in. When it comes in, it is moving through this resistor. When it moves into this resistor, where it's getting in from is a higher potential, where it is getting out from is a lower potential. Likewise, this current, where it is getting in from, it is a higher potential, where it's getting out from is a lower potential. Same story here, current comes in here at a higher potential, gets out here, this is a plus of a lower potential. We do so because current moves from a position of higher potential towards a place of lower potential. So now we look at our loops. Loop 1. In our first loop, we see that this, we are moving in the clockwise direction. Remember, we said that you choose one direction, either clockwise or anticlockwise. So as we are moving from here, we come up here. Through this resistor, we see that we are getting in from negative to positive. So it means across this resistor, we are having a potential gain. So if you are having a potential gain, it means that the voltage across this resistor is a positive. So we're having a positive IR3. This is I2. So it's I2 times R3. Then we come, it comes like that. This is from positive to negative, so meaning there's a potential drop across this resistor, so it becomes minus current I1 times the resistor R1, and that is going to be equal to zero. So this eventually becomes I2 R3 is equal to I1 R1, and that is our equation one. We go to the other loop, the second loop, we call it loop two. In our second loop, we are still moving in the clockwise direction. So as we are moving the up here, we go through this resistor. It is from high potential to low potential. So there is a potential drop. So it means the voltage across this resistor is a negative. So it's going to be negative I1 times R2. And then when we come here, we are moving from negative to positive as we are coming like this. From negative to positive, so there is a potential gain across this resistor R4, so the potential, the voltage across this is going to be a positive. So it's going to be plus I2 R4, and that is also going to be equal to zero. And this will give us I2 R4 will be equal to I1 R2. That's our equation 2, like that. So we have equation 1 and equation 2. And for us to get our balance equation, balance condition, we simply are going to divide equation 2 by equation 1. So dividing 2 by 1, divide equation 2 by equation 1, if equation 2 is going to be I2, R4 is going to be equal to I1 R. And so for balance condition, resistor R4, the resistance of R4 plus over R3 will be equal to R2 over R4. And this is our balance condition for a Wheatstone bridge, and that is how we derive it when we are using Kirchhoff's laws. Now the other way we can derive it is by using the physical quantities or the physical conditions for balance. If we look at our Wheatstone bridge, we said that when current is moving in here, if the potential at D is greater than the potential at C, it means that current will move from the higher potential towards G to that potential, and our galvanometer will deflect. If the potential at C is greater than the potential at D, it means that our current will move like that. Some of it will move there, but some will move like that, and this galvanometer will deflect, and that won't be a balance condition. So for balance condition to happen, it should be that the potential at C should be equal to the potential at D. And if the potential at C is equal to the potential at D, it means that there is no current going through this galvanometer, and so the galvanometer will definitely show zero deflection. If that is so, it means that the potential between A, C and A is the same as the potential between A and D. Likewise, the potential between C and B is the same as the potential between D and B. So for us to derive our balance equation using the physical properties, it means that we are going to find the potential difference across AC and equate that to the PD across AD. We make equation 1. Then we go ahead and get the potential across CB, equate it to the potential across DB. Make another equation, call it equation 2. Then we shall divide the two equations and we shall get our balance condition. For this first equation, it's going to be V, the PD across this, across AC will be the current I times R1 is going to be equal to the current I2 times R3. That is equation 1. Then we go to equation 2, the PD across this should be equal to the PD across that. So the PD across this is going to be I1 times R2 is equal to I2 times R4. And you'll find that we shall be coming up still with equations that are similar to that. And then we do just like here. We divide them and we still get the same balance condition for the Wheatstone bridge. This brings us to the end of this video. Thank you for watching. Somebody out there needs to watch this video. Don't forget to like and share. For more videos, simply subscribe to Kisembo Academy. Otherwise, catch you in the next video. For Kisembo Academy, this is Arnold Ranga Kuramya.